Alfred Matthew Yankovic was born on October 23, 1959, and raised in the Los Angeles suburb of Linwood, California. Nestled between Southgate and Compton, the Linwood of the 1960s and 70s was a laid-back SoCal town. But this was a time of civil unrest and racial tension. When Alfred was seven, a riot broke out in the neighboring community of Watts. The Bloods and Crips were founded and engaged in increasingly bloody street combat. And during Al's sophomore year, one of his classmates, a senior, was kidnapped by three members of the Symbionese Liberation Army, including Patty Hearst, and held for 12 hours while they were on the run after shoplifting from and then shooting at Mel's Sporting Goods, which subsequently led to the police siege of the SLA headquarters. And that did not end well.
I want to talk about the way I knew our six murdered comrades, because the fascist pig media has, of course, been painting a typically distorted picture of these beautiful sisters and brothers.
At the same time, it was an era of great progress. Demographics were changing, and even in California, schools and communities were becoming less segregated. When Al was a child, Linwood was mostly white and Hispanic. By middle school, he would have his first black classmates, and the area had become much more diverse by the time Al graduated as valedictorian of his high school at the age of 16. Mary and Nick Yankovic had their only child late in life, and they were very protective. He was only allowed to ride his bike on their street, and because their house was directly across from the high school, Mary would sometimes watch her son in the schoolyard from their front porch with a pair of binoculars. Despite their strict rules, Alfred felt supported by his parents and his beloved Aunt Dot. Nick would often say, "The key to success is doing whatever for a living makes you happy." A traveling salesman offered the choice of either a guitar or an accordion, a decision that kicked off Alfred's foray into music. He would become classically trained, but would also play along to his favorite rock albums, including Elton John. His influences also included the obscure, bizarre, and funny novelty and comedy performers he'd heard on the Dr. Demento show.
Hello, mother. Hello, father. Here I am at Camp Granada. Camp is very entertaining. And they say we'll have some fun if it stops raining.
All the world seems in tune on a spring afternoon when we're poisoning pigeons in the park. Every Sunday you'll see my sweetheart and me as we poison the pigeons in the park.
Mary may have worried some of the content was inappropriate for a good, upstanding Christian boy, but Alfred would sneak away under his bedsheets to listen. After Barrett Hansen, aka Dr. Demento, visited Linwood Middle School, Alfred recorded a version of his theme song, but the good doctor rejected it. Still, the rough recording of a kid earnestly jamming out on an accordion did have some comic potential. So Alfred was sent a letter encouraging him to keep trying. This would be the earliest phase of Al, the introverted, goofy kid that started the Volcano Worshippers Club just to get another picture in the yearbook.
If we want a better future, changes are imperative, and it is up to every one of us to assume the responsibility of these.
Al's awkward stage carried on as he enrolled in Cal Poly's architecture program. Like many people, he kind of found himself in college. Unprepared to take on the world, Alfred struggled to make friends and live as a functional adult. Some of the boys in the dorm began to tease him, referring to him as Weird Al. Another freshman, Joel Miller, would come to Al's defense, and not long after, the two were having jam sessions in the common area of their dorm. That eventually turned into performances at a local coffee house. Al got involved in the student radio station, KCPR, and his show quickly began to grow in popularity. On weekends, Al and another classmate, Beefalo Bill Burke, would drive down to LA, where they became regular contributors to Dr. Demento's program. That's where he met the man who would become his drummer, John Bermuda Schwartz. Al's confidence and competence grew little by little. The Al of the late 1970s and early 80s was a novelty act with a punk rock bent. He was recording demos on cassette tape, sometimes in dorm rooms or tight radio booths, at least once in the men's room across the hall from the KCPR station. These songs were raw, accordion bleeding into electric guitar, and had a nothing sacred attitude. He kept working hard to earn his architecture degree, but he had a different idea of where his career might go. He'd be a disc jockey on the radio. Then a singular event happened that would change everything. The new station manager at KCPR fired Al for thinking the programming rules didn't apply to him. He was let go despite his show's popularity. Something about this didn't sit right with him. He'd been bullied and had adopted the name those kids had called him and wore it as a badge of honor. He'd risen above that. He'd rise above this. He shifted his focus completely to creating music. His success would be spurred on by spite. By the time he graduated, he was a bit of a celebrity both on and off campus. He returned to Los Angeles with a single, with Capitol Records, and a diploma he knew he didn't want to use.
Without any further ado, the sick man himself, today's stiff of the day, Weird Al Yankovic.
This early Al persists onto the first album, which was produced by rock legend Rick Derringer. They recruited Steve Jay to play bass, and he'd later suggest another accomplished musician for lead guitar, Jim West. John, Steve, and Jim would remain Al's band to this very day. And the new guy, Ruben Valtierra, the keyboardist, has only been around since 1991. By the second album, with the commercial success of Eat It, a parody of Michael Jackson's Beat It, Yankovic began taking things more seriously. Scotty Brothers saw a cash cow. Their star was a mainstay on MTV, had a successful tour in Japan, and artists started saying they knew they'd made it when they got a Weird Al parody. Legend has it, Madonna was musing to a friend she was waiting for Like a Virgin to become Like a Surgeon. The story got back to Al, he ran with the idea, and another hit was born. Scotty Brothers began to demand a record almost every year. The albums became routine and formulaic. Al was tasked with grabbing on to rising stars and staying relevant. It was mostly food and TV, but Al was often struck by inspiration. Despite the duress of Girls Just Want to Have Lunch, there were gems that crackled with genius. The commercial failure of the fourth album, Polka Party, triggered fears of an office job or that he may need to dust off his architectural degree. Al followed his flop with an album called Even Worse. Al was back, proving he might have a viable career after all. Michael Jackson even arranged it so the music video for Fat could be filmed on the same set as Bad. As the 80s turned into the 90s, Al was coming off the commercially disappointing feature film UHF, and his career was in a bit of a slump. he decided to return to the well that had been so successful for him. But Michael Jackson rejected Al's parody of Black or White, Snack All Night, saying,
"That's not funny."
This forced Al to look elsewhere. Smells Like Nirvana, a parody of Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit, kept his career going. And it could be argued it marked a new phase for Al. Incidentally, Kurt Cobain asked if the song would be about food. And he once said Al was the closest thing America has to punk rock. In 1998, Al got LASIK, shaved his mustache, and was unrecognizable in a Hanson video he co-directed. As he said, "If Madonna's allowed to reinvent herself every 15 minutes, I figure I should be good for a change at least once every couple of decades." But Al's appearance wasn't the only thing to have a paradigm shift. About this time, the music industry he'd built a career lampooning collapsed. Al was now a husband and a father, and suddenly had a ton of competition. The internet was changing the rules. People who didn't fit a commercial mold could release their own songs and videos at breakneck speed. He couldn't rely on MTV. They'd moved away from music videos and essentially cut him off. At the same time, the net for potential parody targets had widened exponentially. One group that proved particularly enticing were people of color who no longer had to worry about having what record execs called crossover appeal. These creatives could push genres into new, exciting places, and that had to be inspiring. The Al of the 80s and 90s put on the costumes of James Brown and Bob Marley, but only to riff on their public personas, gentrifying the Rastafarian and giving the hardest working man in showbiz a hernia. He did Isle Thing, I Can't Watch This, and Twister, all sourced from pop charts. Even Eminem's Lose Yourself became yet another song about TV. The Kingmaker, whose parodies made an artist feel like they'd made it, was himself, by this point, a bit of a gatekeeper. The exception to this was the 1996 Coolio parody of Gangsta's Paradise, called Amish Paradise. By obsessively researching two disparate cultures, Al's humor could be seen as coming from an insider. The formula would pay dividends when Al moved away from Mennonites and juxtaposed his own background. It's all about the Pentiums, Puff Daddies, it's all about the Benjamins, and especially White and Nerdy, Chameleonaire's Ryden, both smashed street cred with nerd cred. Just shy of his 47th birthday, Al Yankovic had his first top 10 hit, and it was a cool, complex, cutting-edge rap song. In the 2010s, Al had to dig deeper to prove he could beat the competition that was blowing up online. Exploring music video partnerships and internet leaks of his upcoming album, Al was actually leading the way for other artists who hoped to create buzz online. The last three albums were brimming with biting social satire. He took on recession, celebrity, the litigious system, violence against animals, dictatorships, name-dropping, conspiracy theories, grammar, corporate jargon, sports culture, entitlement, sloth, and the CIA. Sure, this social consciousness had bubbled below the surface for years, occasionally coming up for air with a dog-eat-dog or trigger-happy, but this was punk rock Al Yankovic raging against the machine. Side note, for the cover of his album Alpocalypse, Al plays one of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. He chose to be Famine as a way to signify he was done doing songs about food. Post-album Al is the elder statesman of comedy. This Al voices animated characters for Disney and My Little Pony. He pops up as a musical sidekick for a wacky talk show and drops into cameo roles on TV and in movies. He even makes appearances with the comedy bands and web franchises that owe a debt to his accomplishments. He's commissioned to do official polkas of offbeat rock bands or for the hottest show on Broadway. He subs for Weezer and Portugal the Man in their music videos and portrays Ted Nugent on Reno 911. It's hard to believe there are gatekeepers who still see Al as Capitol Records once did, as a one-hit novelty act, someone they can squeeze a few bucks out of before disposing of. The Holy Trinity of Weird Al, Lin-Manuel Miranda, and the Jim Henson Company pitched a project, and no one in Hollywood bid. How is that possible? The powers that be have never felt Al was deserving of Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction, or a hosting gig on Saturday Night Live, or the cover of a Rolling Stone. But it's all right, Al's never had a seat at the cool table. That spot's never been offered to the valedictorian or the class clown. And our Al is both. Perhaps it's that dichotomy that's confused the stockbrokers who decide what constitutes worthy art. Even at the head of the class, Al's been sitting in the back of the room, making deliberate eye contact with Prince, making friends with the slackers, and cracking jokes. His is a family-friendly brand that won't do a beer commercial, but isn't afraid to take kids down a nature trail to hell. This guy has nerdy fans who keep talking about their nerdy music guy headlining the Jocks' Super Bowl halftime show. Give the Eat It guy an EGOT? Ha! It's in every interview he does with a mainstream host. It's the same four questions. Do you ask for permission to do your parodies?
We do go to all the original writers beforehand and give them the ideas and get their feelings on it. We don't want to step on anybody's toes.
One of the reasons I think I've been able to hang around as long as I have is I don't burn bridges and I want to make sure they're in on the joke.
Did anyone ever refuse to give you permission for a parody?
Everybody asks that. The only person that's really consistently said no has been Prince.
Is it true Paul McCartney refused to give you permission to do a parody?
I hesitate to bring this up. I've talked about it in many interviews, and as you know, Paul and Linda McCartney, strict vegetarians, and
right.
They didn't want to be associated with anything that was condoning the consumption of animal flesh.
Did you make up with Coolio for mistakenly doing a parody of his song after he didn't give permission to do a parody?
I'm not going to say I regret it, but I kind of do. I should have just let it go. We talked and everybody made mistakes.
Rest in power, Leon. Can't they bother to read Wikipedia? 10 things you don't know about Weird Al are 10 things every fan learned on their first day. And that's precisely what makes this new movie so delicious. Whereas the fake trailer is a total fabrication, Weird the Al Yankovic story is a succubus. It starts off like a normal biopic, changing details for dramatic effect, but as the film unspools, it goes more and more off the rails. Hopefully, now you have a deeper appreciation for the level of detail that went into the film, and you can see why this is a movie that seemed to be made especially for hardcore fans like me.
Dude, I've got chills.
Thank you so much for watching this video about such a groovy guy. This is a growing channel. If you want more of this content, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. It really makes a huge difference. If you haven't already, check out the first part of this series, my spoiler-free review of Weird the Al Yankovic Story. And if you still want more, there's a companion blog entry about my experiences as a fan and what I believe Al's legacy will be. Link in the description. I'd like to thank the people who made this video possible. Summer Woods for providing Weird Al Piano Medley 2 and 3 and Take Me Down from her tribute album, Chihuahua Hat.
Zebron Lemke for the use of his song, 27 Happy Seconds.
And Chad Kelson, aka Metal Al, for his metal cover of Fun Zone from his album, Into the Abyss. You can find links to their music in the description. Special thanks to my dear friend, Cindy Boswell Price, who gave me invaluable insight into Linwood High's Class of 76, and to Ethan Ullman of Dave and Ethan's 2000 Inch Weird Al podcast for listening to and fact-checking the script. As always, thanks to my lovely Stella for putting up with me while I obsessively worked on this video. Thanks to Bermuda Chemo, Steve El Maestro, Barrett Hansen, Jay Levy, Tad Dowd, Benin, Tony Scotty, Rick Derringer, Joel Miller, Bill Burke, Suzanne, Nina, Mary, Nick, and all the close personal friends for giving Alfred the support to fulfill his destiny. Lastly, I'd like to thank Al for creating much of the soundtrack of my life and helping kids like me to wear weirdness like a badge of honor. You inspire us every day.
Yo, ding dong, man. Ding dong. Ding dong, yo.